Now, I'm speaking to you as an archaeologist, a curator, and a museum professional, so I wear all these hats. My title is Keeper of Donington and Bosworth. I manage one museum and I'm its curator. That's Donington Heath Manor House and Medieval Manor House. And I'm also the curator at Bosworth Battlefield. Now, Bosworth Battlefield is run by Leicestershire County Council. And Leicestershire itself is in the heart of England, the small blue blob on your map of Britain. Now, we are literally in the heart of the country. Being a county council employee is no bad thing at all. It's very rare for me to come this far afield, I admit. But Leicestershire County Council has a firm commitment to heritage within the area. We've got several castles, visitable castles, within Leicestershire. There are dozens more, which are often in private hands. These are actually run mostly by English Heritage, who's our national body for preserving monuments for the future. We also have a large number of independent community museums. A lot of these are based within small market towns around the county. And Leicestershire County Council, through a government initiative called Renaissance in the Regions, has curators who will work with all the independent museums. And we have a museums, libraries and archives council who will award a status of accreditation for museums that reach a certain standard. And one of our aims is to make sure that all these independent museums can reach that status. And we are actually most of the way there, which is excellent. Within the heart of Leicestershire is Leicester, which is our capital city. That runs its own museum service. Leicestershire County Council then runs these other museums. We also have a record office. The museums and the record office tend to be within the market towns, telling the story of those particular regions from prehistoric times all the way through into the late 20th century. Melton Carnegie Museum in the northeast of the county also houses a museum of the Fox Hunting Trust, which is a very controversial subject, and it's something we need to show both sides of the story. We need to be impartial as museum curators. Bosworth Battlefield is right down in the southwest of the county. So, what is the Battle of Bosworth? This is a battle that was fought in Leicestershire 525 years ago this year. Obviously that's the long distant past, and yet it's something that is actually very important to an awful lot of people. At the battle, the king at the time, Richard III, made famous by William Shakespeare in his play of that title, is defeated by a much smaller rebel army. And one of the reasons he was defeated is that the Stanleys, who are on the south of this map here, came in on the other side. They came in for Henry Tudor. Thomas Stanley was one of Richard's nobles. He was one of his courtiers, but he was also the stepfather to Henry Tudor. So he had a foot in both camps. It's a very intriguing story. If any of you have read William Shakespeare's or seen William Shakespeare's Richard III, you'll see that Shakespeare makes him out to be a crook-backed monster. And that's obviously a certain amount of propaganda. And there are an awful lot of people around the world who are very passionate that Richard III was not a monster. The other thing that's very interesting about this battle, despite the fact that it was over 500 years ago, the local population, particularly in southwest Leicestershire, are so involved. It's their battle. There's a real sense of place and a sense of pride. And that's been a good thing for us at the Battlefield Centre, but also it can cause problems, as we'll see. It's the it's sort of the slight problem with having a lot of local feeling. Richard, as the battle's not going his way, famously charges across the battlefield to try and kill his rival Henry Tudor, but in so doing he actually gets killed himself. And Henry Tudor becomes Henry VII. Now, Bosworth is so important to English history, it's one of our three most important battles, because the Tudor dynasty, founded by Henry, was the dynasty that really put England on the world map. By the end of the Tudor period, after a lot of religious and political upheaval, England was a European superpower, and the empire, good or bad as it was, started to develop from that point. So very important. That's why Leicestershire County Council wanted to commemorate the fact that it happened on our soil. This is a mid-19th century engraving of a place called Ambion Hill. Now, the small buildings you see in the background are a farmhouse which the County Council leased in 1974 as the base for our interpretation of this battlefield. So we don't own the buildings, we lease them. The monument in the foreground was built in 1813, and it marks a well, or a spring, at which Richard III is supposed to have had his last drink of water before, in this case, charging down Ambion Hill to his death. Now, I have to say, if I was the King of England at the time, I'd probably be drinking a nice claret rather than drinking water from a spring, but perhaps that's just me. As you can see from the pictures on the left, in very humble beginnings, we were literally working in cowsheds. The walls weren't particularly lined, but cases were put in, and interpretation panels were put up. At this stage, there were very, very few objects, and the objects that were held were not held by this place. This place was actually run by the property department, a country parks unit, and it was more of a tourist attraction than anything else. In 1985, a big anniversary, they then extended into it with a large new building, which gave them much more space to do more interpretation. And in doing so, they created a lot of very atmospheric spaces. They were very emotional spaces in some cases. You see on the bottom right was a chapel, which has got coat of arms of a lot of the people who were killed at the battle. There's also a diorama, which was very, very popular from small children upwards. And there are people who tell me you can see little marks on the glass as they've looked at this as they've grown up, going up the glass to draw the street. The buildings in the middle of the photo are an atmospheric space showing the sorts of houses the people lived in at the time, but there's no real interpretation there. There's very little information, although it's visually quite nice. Outside, they interpreted Ambion Hill. They interpreted it with a stone where Richard III was supposed to have been killed, and the white roses there are given there annually. Every year, the Richard III Society come along, they drink Richard's memory, and they put white roses on where they think he was killed. And this is a pilgrimage in the true sense. There are also panels interpreting what was happening on the field at the time. So you imagine looking across a landscape, and it would tell you to imagine, you know, soldiers running from the battle or charging in. So again, quite emotional content. But was it actually correct? Considering it's one of our most important battles, it's actually one of the battles we know very little about. Obviously, it was a long time ago, but you'd think a battle in which the King of England was killed would probably be recorded as to where it actually happened. However, from the middle of the 18th century, the battle was fought on Ambion Hill. In 1985, it was fought a kilometre to the southwest, on Reedmore Plain. In 2000, it was moved several kilometres to the west. Now, bear in mind that this is a Leicestershire County Council project. Just to the left of Ratcliffe Coulee is the Warwickshire border. You can imagine our politicians were getting a little bit nervous at that stage. And then most recently, a local historian redid the Ambion Hill theory, moving it slightly to the south. Now, this is a really good case, I think, of intangible heritage, in that all over this area there are people who have alternative oral traditions as to where the battle was. So these people who placed the battle right out to the west, they know where Richard stayed before the battle, they've got a well the same as the one on Ambion Hill, they have lots of field names named after the king, and they insist that that's where the battle happened. Very interesting, because throughout the 18th century have got very much the same information, but over on the east of the site. So it's a two-edged sword, I think. In 2005, Leicestershire County Council decided this is actually needs to be solved. We applied to the Heritage Lottery Fund, who fund a lot of our museum and other heritage projects within England and the UK. And we asked for £1 million, which is quite a lot of money. We could have asked for more money than that, but it would need an awful lot more preparation and more time to actually put in the bid. So we went for £1 million, good round number. Three quarters of that was to fund a new exhibition, and a quarter of it was to fund trying to find out the true location of Bosworth Battlefield. Trying to find out if it was actually possible to find a 500-year-old battle from a time before they were using guns a lot in the battle. So first of all, we had to look at how we were going to bring the Heritage Centre up to date. Bearing in mind, we have a mixture of small farm buildings and this big barn-type building. What we wanted to do was to make the maximum use of the space. And we thought the best way to do it was to give our visitors a journey, an experience where they could really sort of get involved, see how who was involved in the battle, how the battle built up, what happened at the battle, what happened afterwards, why the battle's important. And the galleries were very carefully gone through. We had to make new doors, etc., so that they could go on this time journey. We had designers from Scotland, Studio MB, who we worked very, very closely with. As archaeologists and museum people ourselves, obviously we gave them a very detailed brief. They then told us what was possible with the money, and more specifically, what wasn't possible with the money. And we worked through it there. So lots of thought and dialogue. These are our must-haves. Obviously, we wanted a high-quality experience. We didn't want to put something in if it wasn't going to be high quality, so certain things were stopped. We needed to make sure that everybody that came, A, could actually get in, so it was physically accessible, that they could see what it was we were trying to present. We wanted lots of layers of interpretation. We wanted to mix it up. So yes, lots of graphics, some text, lots of video film, and maps that moved. So we wanted it to be something that everyone could experience and enjoy. We wanted it to be educational, obviously, but we also wanted it to be quite fun, even though it's quite a serious subject. They've got to enjoy it, otherwise they might not actually learn so much. So we always work on the premise that if they can learn five things, having been in the museum for an hour, that's a good thing. Of course, also, you have to be sustainable. You have to be able to clean it. You have to know how to change the light bulbs. You have to know that you can actually afford to sustain it afterwards, because with these sorts of bids, you get a lump sum, but then you've got to be able to maintain it all afterwards. Exciting times, ripping out all the old exhibitions, which was very difficult for some of the members of staff who'd literally hand-built them themselves. But they were very brave, and down they came because they could see the new future. We were working with a company called Silver Knight, who are a local contractor, and very sadly, their parent company went into administration and closed. So, unfortunately, they had to leave us, which is sad for them and very awkward for us. It took us 5 months to find a replacement company, and they had to redo all the electric wiring because they couldn't write off someone else's work. So, £100,000, and 6 months later, a new company, Charmanshaw, came in and started the work again.